What's up, everybody? Dan here with Dan and Sarah Makers, and we've got another fantastic episode of Tool Tuesday for you today. So I'm going to pose a question to you. We're going to look at probably, in my opinion, one of the most underrated, all-purpose, amazing tools out there. So we're going to look at a tool that is just as indispensable for someone that installs granite countertops as a welder. I mean, this tool works for everybody, and it does something that pretty much no other tool out there can, and it is just universal. So what tool could it be? I don't know. It's not that expensive when it comes to tools, and it is a power tool. So let's take a peek. So what is this mystery tool, you ask? Well, like I said, it works just as well for welders as it does for stone guys. I've got my weld here, looking good, but I need to clean it. So we are looking at the 4.5-inch angle grinder. This thing does everything. And honestly, they're pretty inexpensive. You can get a really good one for $60 to $80, and a really inexpensive one probably at Harbor Freight for $10. So it depends on what you want to do with it, but this is the tool that you should have in your toolbox or out in your shed. This thing is incredible. So enough of the dress up. Let's get into the different features of not only the grinders that are out there, but the type of accessories or the thing that makes the grinder work, the wheels. So let's do this thing. As you can see here, I've got four different grinders on the table. These are all 4.5-inch diameter capacity grinders, which means that the grinding attachment, I guess we could say, is 4.5 inches in diameter maximum. There are different sizes. I actually don't have any. I've seen them down to 3-inch, 4.5-inch, 5-inch, 6, 7, 9-inch. Those are all pretty common sizes of grinders, but the most typical, I would say, that the average person is going to have or worker will have is a 4.5-inch. So grinders are, just as they say, they grind. They remove material by scraping, and it's a very high-speed scrape, basically. I know the European measurements of speed, they measure the edge speed. So basically, if this was a wheel rolling down the road, how fast would that wheel be going at the edge, or how fast would it propel it? They're talking about 80 meters a second. So that's, what is that? We're looking at about 240 feet per second, which we can convert that into miles per hour if we really want to. But that's really fast. And what they do is they throw that debris into the air into a collection system, which I'll show you here in a little bit. But grinders are a little bit dangerous because of that. So first and foremost, know what you're trying to grind and know what potential hazards that material may pose on you or the surrounding environment that you're working in. If you're working with masonry, whether it's concrete or stone or tile or something like that, there's silica dust in masonry, the stone and the concrete and cement and all that, not good for you. So you either want to use respiration, you want to use ventilation, you want to use a collection system, you want to use water, something like that to minimize your exposure to that silica dust, which causes silicosis and cancer and all that kind of stuff. Also, if you've been removing floor tiles, say those 12-inch, 1-foot square, they call them VCT or vinyl composition tile. You see them a lot on the floors in Walmarts and grocery stores and old churches and stuff like that, and even houses used to have it. Be aware that depending on what age that VCT is, either the adhesive or the tile itself may have asbestos in it. A lot of times if you see black adhesive under flooring, whether it's carpet or linoleum or tile, be really cautious of that because the black stuff tended to be of the era where asbestos was in it. Again, if you kick that stuff into the air, it becomes airborne, you can inhale it, asbestosis and mesothelioma and all that bad stuff that you don't want. Again, metal. Metal shaving's not the best, and even the carborundum discs, which are the black abrasive style disc that you can use for grinders, can kick stuff up into the air. So enough with the safety portion on that. There are corded electric grinders, obviously, and then there's a battery-powered grinder that I've got here. There are two main types of switches that you're going to find on grinders. They call them a lock-on switch and a dead man switch. And the difference is, this particular grinder has a locking switch where I slide it forward. Kind of hard to do it with that hand. I slide it forward and it locks into the on position. That means that it could be on running right now. I could set it down. I could set it on the table and it could potentially roll away if it's still on. So that's a locking switch. It's nice because sometimes you're using a grinder for a really long time and holding a dead man switch, which is this style of switch here, there's a little safety tab or lever here that you actually have to depress and then you can push the switch on. A dead man switch, you have to hold that switch down and as soon as you let go, it will flip into the off position, shut the machine off, and is safer than a lock-on switch. Now, all three of these grinders have that lock-on switch. This one has a dead man switch. This one's nice in that when you're done grinding and you put the grinder down, the wheel is going to slow down over a few seconds and stop. Also, if you set the grinder down, if that wheel is spinning and it comes into contact with the ground, the floor, whatever, sometimes they can take off and just spin away. That's also an issue, you know. You set it down, you got your extension cord there, and all of a sudden it eats your cord. I've seen it happen. So the dead man switch is beneficial in some situations. If you're doing a lot of grinding for a lot of time, the lock-on switch are typically pretty nice. Those switch options are typically, as far as I know, they're only really an option in corded grinders. I don't know if they're in cordless grinders yet. So there are two ways that grinding discs attach to your grinder. There is the style where you've got this clamping ring, which all these grinders come with that option. And so basically you have a backer plate that mounts to the grinder, and typically these actually have flats on them, so it will find a spot and it'll drop down and kind of lock into place so it doesn't slide. And then you've got a wheel that clamps on and actually squeezes the grinder disc itself. These wheels are offset so that there's a gap in one direction in between these two clamping plates, and then they're tight in the other direction. That is because there are two main thicknesses of grinder discs that you clamp on. And the thicker discs, you want a little bit more stability since you can actually have stability. So you use it where they gap in between. And I'll show you here. All right, so we've got the clamp-on style, and then we have a screw-on style, where we actually take those two clamping pieces off the grinder, and we've also got a screw-on style. Now, all of these grinders have a locking button somewhere on the top here that locks out the spindle so we can screw and unscrew our discs. So there's a universal size, I believe it's a 5/8 by 11, so it's a 5/8 diameter shaft, 11 threads per inch. So we get all sorts of grinder discs with actual threaded collars built into the disc themselves. They're more expensive, they're bulkier, but if you're on a job site where you've got a lot of people working and people don't care about their tools as much, they tend to lose the key for tightening and loosening these mounting plates here, and they tend to lose those mounting plates. So unfortunately, a lot of companies will go with this screw-on style. They're bulkier, more expensive, as I said, but the employees don't run the risk of losing the tools that make the grinder work. One trick, sometimes I've seen guys have lots of trouble getting these off in the field. What you can do is you can actually lock the collet, and you can take the grinder and basically bump it when it's unplugged on the ground and push it so that the ground unscrews it and kind of loosens it up that way. Not the best trick in the world, but it's a way of doing it. So let's look at the different types of grinding discs themselves. here. And we'll start with metal. Almost all these discs here are carborundum. Well, all of them are carborundum type grinding discs. Most of them are cutting discs. This style over here is actually a grinding disc. So this one is much thicker than all the cutting discs. As you can see, it's probably 3 times thicker than a cutting disc. That means that we can actually grind by pushing on a surface like that. They're designed to take force this way, not just this way. So they're much thicker and heavier than a standard disc. This one here, well, all these except for these over here are a clamp-on style, so we'll have to use those little rings or plates to actually screw and clamp the blade onto our arbor. This particular Pearl Abrasives, these red lines, I actually personally really like these. These seem to last a long time, and they tend to do a really good job. We've got these two styles of discs here. These are also cutting discs, and they're flat. So when you look at the side profile of the disc, it is a flat surface or plane. There's no offset like these discs over here have. So these are good for cutting if you don't need to get into a tight corner or something like that, or really close to an adjacent surface. So these discs are handy in that way. Discs will be listed on the different types of metals or materials that they're good for. And you can get these in slightly different thicknesses, but they're all pretty thin. These are a depressed center cutting disc, and these are not flat. These will actually minimize the amount of the grinder arbor and the clamping plate that stick out on one side, so you can get a little bit closer to an adjoining surface. So these are clamp-on, and then these are the screw-on ones. Like I said, these are much more expensive, and they take up a lot more room. This particular box here, it has only 10 discs in there, or actually all of 10 discs. That takes up a lot more room than a stack like this. So the carborundums have been around for a long time, but they've actually been potentially surpassed by something new, which is this. So Lennox just came out with these not too long ago, and I assume probably all the other companies are going to come out with something very similar very soon. This particular disc, I believe, was about $14. And they claim that this one disc will outlast 30 of these discs. I don't know for sure. I haven't used this one yet. But they say that it's going to maintain its diameter, so it doesn't get smaller and smaller, reducing its cutting capacity. It cuts cooler because it actually uses a diamond grit in this outside edge, so there's less chance of fire and things like that. There's no carborundum being abraded off these discs being thrown into the air, so health-wise that's good, and they're cleaner. And with it cutting cooler, you have less chance of fire. I worked on one job where I had to put out one of my coworkers' legs because he was grinding steel with one of these discs, these abrasive discs, and all the sparks were hitting his insulated, like, Carhartt coverall pants. And he didn't realize it, and I look over, and his pants are crawling up with flame and burning away. So I had to go over there and swat his leg out. He wasn't quite sure what I was doing at first, but these can cause fires. I've seen it. So anyways, these discs are more expensive than these discs, but these discs here being $2 to $3 to $6 a piece potentially, one disc that might take up actually all these discs here, this is supposed to take or be able to cut the same capacity as all these. So time will tell. So yeah, this definitely a new option. They sell these all the way up to the 14-inch chop saw grinders. So they're a little bit more expensive. They're $120, $150, somewhere around there for the big 14-inch diameter. But if you're looking at one disc, that's not bad. That's a pretty good deal. So that's the metal cutting discs. Here we've got an assortment of different types of wire wheels. All of these wire wheels are attached to the threaded shank or spindle on a grinder. And I've got like two, whatever main types, however you want to break them up. We've got what are called cup grinders. And these basically have the wires sticking out perpendicular to the grinder. So they're good for surfaces. These are twisted wires. So basically we take the wires and we break them up into clumps and we spin them around into little braided twists. As you can see, this is a new one. This is a used one. The used one has a lot shorter and a lot fewer wires on it. This is a straight or crimped wire grinding cup. And again, a used one, a new one. This one's still got some life on it, but you'll also notice that it has a lot fewer wires than the new one. And then we have the flat style. And again, we've got our twisted and we've got our straight or crimped wires. These are good for when you're chasing a seam, say after you've welded something, especially an inside corner. The twisted wheels tend to be a lot better for really aggressive grinding. You can push a lot harder. They're stiffer. They'll get in there and they will grind much better than a crimped wheel. So one thing to be aware of with these is that, as I showed you, the used ones tended to have a lot fewer wires on them and it'll be a lot shorter. The wires break and they fly off. So I pulled them out of my pants before where they've flown off and embedded in my pants. Even with a shroud or guard on your grinder, they can fly and hit you in the hands. And of course, if they can hit you there, they can hit you in the neck, they can hit you in the face, wherever. So wear proper PPE when you're using these things, because those little wires, even though they don't have a lot of mass, they're traveling really fast and they do hurt and you do have to pull them out. So your eyes are probably going to be the worst if you do get them in there. Using a guard, paramount. Again, grinders put your hands very, very close, probably closer than any other tool, to the cutting wheel. So if you don't have a guard on there and your hand's right there and you slip, these things are not forgiving. They will take you down to the bone really, really fast. So they're great tools to have. Not only are they good for grinding metal and cleaning metal up, you can remove a lot of surface corrosion with these things. And then you can remove different types of adhesives and materials and things like that. I've had to use them where I was taking off linoleum, felt-backed linoleum, and the felt was stuck to the floor with adhesive. Sometimes you just need a grinder to get in there and grind all that material off. Takes a while, but sometimes that's your best option. So for concrete, masonry, stonework, there are a certain number of discs that we can use. A lot of them are diamond impregnated, or they have diamond particles in them that actually do the cutting. There are a few carborundum style discs. This one is a clamp-on. It's a thick disc, and look specifically on the disc for the description that it works for masonry. This is okay for grinding, say, form seams off of forms or concrete after formwork has been removed. You potentially could maybe use this if there's like a crack or a lip in a sidewalk where there might be a trip hazard, but this would take a long, long time to do. So these carborundum discs are really only useful for small grinding. This particular one here, this is a big cup grinder. It mounts to the arbor and you can actually hold it and grind smooth on a surface. Again, these are useful for removing form marks on concrete when you've pulled your forms off. When we're talking about grinding surfaces smooth, there are a couple different grinders, grinding attachments. These are both diamond, and these are designed for smooth grinding. Again, as the wheel turns, we've got these diamond segments that are all flat in a plane that will grind surfaces. So you can shape things. This one here I've used a lot for like toe pointing type stuff, like grinding like this. So the actual diamond segments are a little bit rounded. So this won't give me as smooth a surface as a disc kind of like this, or an attachment like this, where it's got very wide segments and it hasn't been used on like a toe-in type purpose where I've got it at an angle. Use this flat, get a nice smooth surface. There are a couple different cutting discs that you can get. These are both diamond cutting discs. This is what is known as a segmented rim, where there's actually cuts in the rim. These help for heat. As the disc heats up, it expands, and these little segments here help reduce that heat differential. So this is a segmented rim cutting disc. This one is a continuous rim, and it's got little flutes that kind of come out in a spiral, and that basically pulls not only air, but it also helps remove dust and debris as you're cutting. So these are nice to have. They're a little spendy, but if you're cutting tile, which I'll show you, or you're cutting brick or even scoring concrete, so you have a really bad crack in concrete or a blown out area and you want to cut into the concrete, you know, an inch, half an inch, and then chisel that out to do a patch, these are really nice for that kind of work. For fine stonework, say you've got a granite countertop or something, and you've got a little bit of grinding and polishing, actual like real nice high-end polishing you want to do, they have these Velcro-faced rubber-backed pads. And these are actually for stone polishing. Again, it threads onto your grinder. And you just take these abrasive, diamond abrasive pads. And these are made by Apollo Stone Art. And there are many, many different grits. But Apollo. And it on the Velcro face here, it tells you what the grit is. They get very, very fine. This is a 200. This one's an 800. This one's a 50, so a little bit more aggressive. And here's another 50. These basically have plastic teeth all around the face that have an abrasive diamond in them. And these will polish up concrete, they'll polish up stone, they'll polish up all sorts of masonry products as long as it's solid. It wouldn't polish up a cinder block or CMU block. But these will actually polish it up. They're a wet polish, so you have to have water on the surface, which, you know, again, be cautious using water with power tools. But those are really nice for polishing stone and concrete. When you're dealing with masonry, it gets really dusty, really nasty. This is an aftermarket shroud that you can take the protective shield or guard off your grinder. You slip this over it, and then it comes with a small clamp that you can clamp on, and then you hook your vacuum cleaner to this. And that will allow you to grind with a lot less dust being blown into the air. This is obviously a Hilti version of that. This one has a brush basically around the rim. And when you need to get close to a wall when you're grinding, you'll take this shield and you can actually pop it off to the side. And then you can get right up to an adjoining surface because it'll expose the edge of the disc. So it would basically look something like that, where the very edge of the disc is exposed. When you get away from the wall and you want better containment, you flip this back over, clip it, and of course you'll have this attached to your dust collection system. If you have a dust collection system, a lot of the new vacuums actually have a point where you plug your power tool into the face of the vacuum, and once you turn your power tool on, the vacuum will automatically turn on, and then a lot of times when you turn your power tool off, the vacuum will run for, say, 5 seconds, clear out any remaining dust in the line, and then the vacuum will shut off. So that's for masonry, concrete, stonework, things like that. These discs here are kind of a universal disc. They list them as being for metal, and that's fine. But these are flat discs, or an abrasive flat disc. So basically what they are is there are many, many small rectangles of sandpaper that have been cut out and lined up and glued in this kind of flap or almost like a domino shape all the way around this disc. What that does is as you use this disc, the abrasives will wear out where they're exposed and it'll actually expose more abrasive disc down. So these kind of are kind of like shark teeth, you know, as the shark wears out their old teeth, they've got new teeth coming in. So that's kind of what this is like. Again, these are the two different arbor types. We've got the screw-on arbor and then the clamp-on arbor. These, they list them as being used for metal, which is fine because they'll grind and polish and they'll remove rust and corrosion and things like that on metal, which is great. They are also really useful for woods and plastics. The first time I ever used these, we were installing bathroom shower surrounds, and we were using a pretty thick plastic laminate. So normal countertop laminates, 3/32, 1/8 inch, 1/16 inch, something like that. Very, very thin typically. I've seen it much, much thinner. But for these shower surrounds, we were actually using plastic laminate that was over 1/4 inch thick. So when you're putting your panels in for the back of your shower, sometimes the back walls are doing weird things and you need to scribe the panel to the wall so you kind of get it in diagonally. You draw your pencil along the edge and your pencil will actually follow the adjoining wall and draw your line onto your panel. It's not a straight line, it's got whoopties, it's got bellies, it's got all kinds of things that you've got to try and follow. Cutting that with a pair of shears or a circular saw, not the greatest. Plastic laminate tends to chip a lot. So what we would do is we would use these flat discs on our grinder and we would just follow that line with it kind of back beveled to the back side of the panel and just look at the front of the panel and follow that. Then we'd stick it in, scribe the other side, grind it smooth, put it in. We'd use these a lot for countertops where the backsplash goes into the back wall. Again, these are really handy. They don't chip when you use them that way. And you can scribe it to a wall. You can use them for solid surface materials like Corian or Silestone, things like that. So these are really, really handy. It's also nice when you've got wood. Certain types of more decorative wood, you'll have issues with trying to get trim work up against a wall. A lot of times, baseboards, things like that, where the floor is uneven. Again, we can use this to scribe that baseboard to the floor. If the tile, say the tile guy did a bad job and they've got lipping in between one large tile and another, but we want our baseboard to be nice and tight, we scribe that, we come through with our grinder, we grind it, get match that profile. So these are really, really handy for not only metal, but woods, laminates, plastics, synthetic stones, things like that. So these are great. I don't know if they still make them. I hope they don't. There's a company, Lancelot Tools, where they basically made a clamp for a chainsaw blade, and they had a small chainsaw chain that was clamped around a grinder disc. And they use those. Originally, they talked about using them for like wood carving, things like that, like bearers that you buy on the side of the road out in the woods or whatever. For wood carving, it's an extremely dangerous option. One of my early bosses had them and loved them, and it was scary every time he used them. I mean, you set the grinder down, they take off because they catch something. You hit something a little bit harder than you were expecting, or you didn't have a good enough grip on the grinder, and it takes off. It does all kinds of weird things. And it's a chainsaw, again, running, just a couple inches from your hand. And he was one of those guys that didn't think that guards were necessary. He carried utility knives open in his pants pockets and his dockers, and then he'd throw them to you if you needed a knife or he thought you needed a knife. And then he'd wonder why you're like, ah, I'm not catching that. Well, that was the kind of guy he was. Nice enough guy, but kind of absent-minded. So those are what I would recommend for wood. All right, well, that was another long Tool Tuesday video. So if you made it this far, thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed learning about some of these angle grinders, the different types and the different components that we can use with our grinders and uses. So anyways, this is Dan with Dan and Sarah Makers. Hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to like, comment, subscribe, share, do all those good things, and stay tuned for another one. Have a good one. Bye.